Okay, welcome everyone, and thank you again for joining us today. We appreciate you jumping on, and I'm sure we'll have some more hop on here in a bit. So I'm joined today by Julian Huenerfauth. He is one of our career services coordinators within the Co-op and Career Services office. He is a phenomenal resource for anything career and co-op related. So we wanted to spend a little time today speaking on that, as I know a lot of folks have questions on that, especially our international students, regarding how that can fit into your plan of study at the graduate level, as it certainly can, not required, but it is an option. So without further ado, I'll turn it over to Julian, and we'll get started.
Thanks, Matt. Hi, everybody. As Matt said, my name is Julian Huenerfauth. I'm an assistant director in the Office of Career Services, and I am the career service coordinator for many of the programs in the College of Business, including the MBA and the Master's of Business Analytics. So today we're going to talk about experiential learning and the co-op program. And so the first thing that I want to tell you about is our office. So our office is actually not located within the College of Business. We are located in the same building as admissions. So when you first come to RIT, you'll interact with our building because this is the building when you come to drop off your transcripts. The admissions building, it's one of the first buildings that you will see when you come into the university. It's right off parking lot E. It's called the Bausch & Lomb Center. And our office hours are from 8:30 a.m. to 4:30 p.m. And as RIT students, you have the ability to make appointments with your career services coordinator for any type of career advice. We also have drop-in hours, and those, you know, sometimes vary. So you gotta take a look in our system to see what the walk-in hours are every day, and then you can just come in and chat if you have a quick question. So RIT's co-op history. So as you can see, we have been doing co-ops for over 110 years. So it kicked off with 32 students at a couple of companies. And now we have more than 3,672 students that have completed over 4,790 work assignments with over 2,000 companies and nonprofits. So we have a very large list of employers that actively recruit RIT students who are interested in your talent and who are eager to interact with you and give you co-op and full-time opportunities. RIT has one of the largest and oldest co-ops in the world. So what is co-op? We define co-op as full-time paid employment in your field of study. And so as such, full-time, you know, we're expecting that you're gonna be working 35 hours or more per week. We require companies to pay a competitive salary. They need to at least pay minimum wage, but most companies, especially at the grad level, pay well above minimum wage for co-op salaries. It has to be directly related to your program, right? So if you are a student in the business analytics program, you have to make sure that whatever you're doing for your co-op is using those skills that you're learning in your classes, because co-op is supposed to be an opportunity for you to enhance and expand those skills in a practical setting. Something that's very cool about co-op is that it's tuition free. And so while you're on co-op, you are officially still registered as a full-time student of the university, but you do not have to pay to go on co-op. And so the benefit of that is that it can help you, you know, with saving a little bit of money that can go, you know, directly into paying your next semester, for example. And your living expenses. Co-ops must be supervised and evaluated by a manager in the workplace. And so how we do that is that when a co-op is registered, you have to identify who your direct supervisor will be And then we connect with them and give them access to our evaluation system, where they will write an evaluation report of your performance at the end of the co-op. Co-ops can be a single term or two consecutive terms. And so for business students, it is most common to do a single term, and it'll be like a summer term, where most of the companies hire, but sometimes you will see students that decide to combine and they do like a 6-month co-op. And so that we call those a double block. And that usually is going to be a summer, fall, assuming that you're starting your degree in the fall semester, right? And because we've been doing this for over 100 years, our academic advisors are really good at incorporating co-op within your curriculum so that you can seamlessly do your co-op without affecting your time to graduation too much, yeah, right? And so if you're in the MBA program, a co-op can fit very easily between year one and two, and there's not gonna be any delays for graduation. If you're doing any of our master's degrees that are normally about 17 months, then you might need to think, if you want to do a co-op, you might need to like stay an extra semester because you're not taking classes that summer, right? But very easy to set up. And also, even though you're extending your program a little bit by doing that co-op, you're not paying extra money because you don't pay tuition while you're on co-op. So some benefits of co-op, it can help define your career path after graduation. Sometimes when students come in and they start doing their degrees, they know that they want the knowledge, they know that they want to enhance their skills, but they are not 100% sure about what it is that they want to do with the degree after graduation. And co-op lets you go out and test it out, right? It lets you see if you are, if a certain type of work is going to be something that you can envision yourself doing every day for several years in the future. And, you know, going and confirming that is great, but also going and realizing like, oh, this is not really what I wanna do, is also great because it allows you to then come back and make a little bit of a shift in your electives or the classes that you're taking so that you can look for other opportunities you know, in a slightly different field after graduation. It helps you apply the theory that you're learning in your classes in real professional situations. So something that we are very clear with when we interact with employers is that when they hire students for co-ops, the students need to be working on real projects and making a real impact for the company. You will earn a reasonable salary, which again can help finance your education. It'll allow you to develop additional technical skills and also enhance your soft skills. And so soft skills are really important. They are those skills that allow you to be successful and effective when you're working with others. And those are very well developed during your co-op programs, because you're going to be put in a situation where you're walking into working with a team and you're going to be just helping develop different things with them. Additionally, RIT itself is a university that has a teaching philosophy that helps develop these soft skills, because a lot of your classes will also include team projects and things like that that will allow you to develop these skills as well. Co-ops also help you network with team members and professionals in the company, which can accelerate your future job search. So when you are put into a situation like a co-op, you have the ability to go and talk to higher ups within the company, people in other departments, also the people that you're working with. And all of a sudden, these people become part of your network, and that can be really useful for your full-time job search. Additionally, having a co-op on your resume will help you stand out to recruiters later on when you're looking for your job search, because you are going to have extra work experience that somebody that didn't do a co-op will not have. So let's talk a little bit about the student responsibility in terms of co-op. So the primary responsibility for obtaining a co-op is the students. And so how you're going to do that is making sure that you're regularly checking co-op postings and on-campus interviews that we post on our Career Connect system, and making sure that you attend career fairs, networking events, and you are connecting with your career services coordinator and using the resources that are in place to help you find those positions. The earlier you connect with us, the more successful you're going to be, right? If you wait until, you know, a month before you want to go on co-op, you're going to find that your search is going to be a lot harder because of the way that the recruiting cycles work. So something that often surprises students is that they come in and they start in the fall and they have to start searching for that summer co-op within a couple of weeks of arriving to campus. And that is because of how the business recruiting cycles happen. And so we are here to help you prepare for that job search, to help you develop your resumes and your elevator pitch for the career fair, and to how to showcase your skills so that you can be successful during that job search. Another part of your responsibility is making sure that you're reporting your co-ops to our office. And so we do that electronically. There's a specific website for it. And it is also your responsibility to complete the co-op experience in full. So once you have accepted a co-op with a company, you must stay there for the entire duration of that co-op that you have made a commitment to. I mean, of course, there can be extenuating circumstances where like that might not be the case, but you cannot just decide like, oh, I want to go do something else now, so I'm going to quit this company early. Like, that's not allowed, right? So in terms of eligibility, graduate students must be in good academic standing. And so that means a 3.0 GPA. And you must have completed one academic year. So if you're starting the program in fall of 2023, you will be first eligible to go on co-op for summer of 2024. However, as I mentioned earlier, a lot of companies do their summer recruiting during that fall. And so that's very important for you to understand that we need to start working together on that job search from the moment you get here, so that you're ready for that summer. If you happen to be an international student, you will also need authorization from the International Student Services Office. And then the rule of having been for a full year or like two consecutive full-time academic terms is even more strict for international students, because that is a restriction of your visa, right? And so just gotta keep that in mind. Our employers love our co-op students. So they rank our co-op students high in areas of innovation. They rank high in critical like thinking, in being reliable, and also the ability to pick up new technology and skills. I think that comes from being in an environment like RIT where technology is embedded into everything we do. But also they find our students to be very adaptable and ethical. And that's, I feel like that's a statement to the high quality of our professors and the education that RIT provides our students. Some of the fastest growing industries in terms of you know, industries that you might want to look into after graduation. So anything that has to do with solar and wind energy, any renewables, those industries are growing really fast. Anything that has to do with data analytics also, we're seeing a lot more. Anything that has to do with AI, we're seeing a lot more jobs in those industries. Software development, information security, game design and development. Now, these are industries, not necessarily job functions, right? So you see that some of these things is like, oh, but these are like technical fields. I'm going for a business degree. Those companies, in order to be able to grow, also need business people, right? They need data analysts, they need MBAs, they need finance people, they need marketing people. And so looking for those types of roles within these types of industries can be a good opportunity for you guys moving forward. And so how we can assist, right? So we provide individual career advisement. And so you are able to meet with me or with Mindy, who is our other business career services advisor. And you can meet with us as many times as you need to, right? So we're happy to help you with anything related to the job search. So like resume reviews, mock interviews. We can help talk about job search strategy, about how to do employer outreach, how to use Career Connect, which is our like our online job board, basically. So employers post thousands of jobs every year on our Career Connect system for both co-op and full-time positions. And so we'll teach you how to use that system and take advantage of it. We also do career workshops. And so throughout the year, to prepare you for the job search. So we'll have workshops on all of the topics like resume reviews or like, resume writing, cover letter writing, how to create an elevator speech, how to negotiate your salary, how to network with employers. And so we cover all of those topics through workshops. Additionally, part of my role as an assistant director in this office is I lead the initiatives for international students. So I also do a whole separate speaking series on how to succeed in the United States. And so we'll have different workshops that we'll do during the semester. So, hopefully you'll come and join us and keep an eye out on the marketing for those, because those are great sessions to help international students succeed in the US. Basically those are the services that we provide. Oh, and I almost forgot our career fairs. So we have two major career fairs that we host every year, one in the spring and one in the summer. Our spring career fair, which is normally our smaller career fair, just happened a couple months ago, and we had 240 employers attend. And so this is the picture that you're seeing is kind of like what one of our career fairs looks like. It's just hundreds of companies with hundreds of recruiters talking to our students. They are campus-wide career fairs, so there'll be companies recruiting for all sorts of majors, including business. So they're a great opportunity for you to come up and talk to employers and, find opportunities. And we also do a lot of sessions to help prepare you on how to navigate the career fair. So how to make a strategy, how to research the companies ahead of time, how to identify the jobs or the companies that are specifically looking for your skill set. So all of those are things that we cover in the workshops leading up to the career fairs. And now I'm happy to answer any questions. It looks like there's a few things in the chat.
Yes, thank you, Julian. Appreciate it. So there is one question here. I'll read it out so folks can hear it. So as an international student, I have to secure a co-op position as soon as I begin the program, but I also need to get permission to complete at least 6 months of coursework before starting my co-op.
So as an international student, you are required to complete 2 semesters of full-time classes before starting your co-op. So that means that if you start in the fall, you'll have the fall semester and you have to do at least 9 credits to be full-time. And then the spring semester where you're doing at least 9 credits to go to be full-time, right? And that makes you eligible for CPT, which is curricular practical training, which is a part of your F1 visa that will allow you to work in the United States. Now, because of the way that the recruiting cycles happen for business, even though you're not eligible until the summer, you need to start the job search in the fall, right? And so we can work together to get you ready for that job search, to get your resume and your, you know, your personal presentation information and stuff like that, so that you can interact with employers, so that you can start applying for those things and hopefully get an offer that will start in the summer. Now, if you go through the full recruiting process and you don't get anything, there will still be opportunities in the spring for the summer. So don't think that if you don't get something right away, you're not get it. You're just not gonna get a co-op. But it's very important to start in the fall because A, there's plenty of opportunities in the fall that will not be available in the spring. And so you're gonna miss out on some things for not participating. And B, because even if you don't get something in the fall, having gone through one recruiting process during the fall already will give you skills that will make you more successful when you go through the cycle again in the spring.
Thank you, Julian. Yeah, I think that's such a vital point. We were literally just talking about this yesterday in a meeting we had about students being prepared to start that process even before they're even on campus, and just in terms of getting a sense of what opportunities there are. So I think that's a really valid point. Okay, so we do have another question. Will H-1B visa sponsorship include all nationalities, or is it limited in this regard? Also, some sources, go ahead, go with the first one. There was a follow-up, but go ahead.
So the H-1B visa is agnostic to nationality, so there's no limit there. The limit is in the number of H-1B visas that are issued every year. So the government allows for 85,000 H-1B visas every year. And so when you graduate with an RIT degree or any degree, a master's degree, you will have access to what's called OPT. And that's part of the same F-1 visa that you come in as a student. And so that OPT is called optional practical training. You apply for it, 3 months before graduation. You get an employment authorization card, and then you can go and work with a company automatically for up to 1 year. Now, if the degree that you are graduating from happens to be a STEM degree, which I think all of our master's programs in Saunders are, then you can extend that OPT period for an extra 2 years by using what's called STEM OPT. Now, not every single company is allowed to hire STEM OPT. They have to meet some requirements, but most companies can. And so you'll be able to work for up to 3 years altogether without needing an H-1B sponsorship. Now, when it's time for the company to decide that they want to sponsor you, then they need to do the process. There are specific deadlines of when that needs to happen, and they file. And so it's a lottery system. And if you get picked on that lottery system, then your visa, H-1B visa gets processed. And then you are able to work with that company. The H-1B visas last 3 years, and you can renew it once.
Thank you, Julian. Appreciate that. Mm-hmm. And then the follow-up to that was just resources or sources that could help find those companies that sponsor H-1Bs.
Yes, we actually have a website it's a platform basically that we purchased a couple of years ago. It's called Interstride. And so in that platform, you can go and research companies and analyze what type of jobs they sponsor for, how many jobs of each type they sponsored for in the past year. And it also has a job search engine that cross-references job postings with the top 500 H1B companies. And so it's going to serve you positions that are H1B eligible that you can apply directly through that platform. Does all students could apply for CPT? Did you have any experience that CPT was an issue for a student? No. So yes, any student can apply for CPT. That application is done through our Office of International Student Services. As long as you meet the requirements, which are that you are enrolled in the program, that you have completed two semesters of full-time classes, and that you have an offer, like a co-op offer that has been accepted by your college and registered in our student management system as a co-op, that's all that's required for you to be able to get CPT. Like that's, it's almost immediate. It takes about a week to process.
Great. Thank you, Julian. These are great questions too. And I just want to reiterate Julian's point on the STEM designation for our programs. All of our on-campus programs are now STEM designated, including the MBA. So that's a really important point to keep in mind. It's a really big value add for students, certainly international students for sure. And we're at a point now where within our graduate programs in business, we're almost a 50-50 split on international and domestic. So, we have a really good culture and diversity at the graduate level with our student body. All right, other questions that that folks have, certainly feel free to use the chat or, you can unmute yourself as well. So average salary or median salary, which one is a better indicator to consider in your minds? I know we have a lot of resources there as well, so.
Yeah, so that's an interesting question. I think that it's good to look at both. And so you can see what the median and the average salary, because that gives you a better picture of like what the distribution might be. Yeah. And all of that information is on the Career Services website. So if you go RIT, great. So in the Career Services website, there's a table basically that shows the salaries for both co-op and full-time from the past graduation year. And so that can give you a little bit of an idea of what the salaries might be. CPT, the question is, if CPT extends to 12 months, is not allowed to apply for an extended OPT. So here's the deal. With CPT, I guess by law, you're entitled up to 364 days, which is the absolute maximum that you can do for CPT. However, just because the government says that you can have like basically a year of CPT, that doesn't necessarily mean that your program will allow a whole year of CPT. So you are going to be able to do the amount of CPT that your program allows you. In Saunders, we usually allow one co-op, and that one co-op can be either a summer or a summer fall, right? Or if you start off cycle, it can be like a spring or a spring summer or something like that, right? Depending at what point you become eligible to go on co-op. We usually don't encourage students to do a whole year of CPT because we want them to be able to move through their program. Now, the other thing, the risk part of what we're doing is because if you happen to go beyond the amount of CPT that the government allows, then you lose your OPT. And that would be a terrible thing to do because you want your OPT because that's what's gonna allow you to work in the United States after graduation. Just keep your CPT under a year and then you can go for your full OPT.
Great. So what other questions do folks have? These are great questions. So keep them coming if there are more.
How does one co-op last in general? So normally a co-op, like a summer co-op, will be between 10 and 12 weeks. And so that's a typical co-op. A co-op that's done in the spring or the fall might be a little longer. We're looking at maybe 12 to 14 weeks usually. And so then if you combine both, you can say that a co-op can be up to like, I don't know, like almost 8 months. If you did something starting like in May and went all the way to December. So that's kind of like the upper ends of what a co-op can last.
All right. Go ahead, Julian. Sorry.
No, just gonna say that sometimes what happens, what can happen as well, is that we've seen situations where a student goes and they do a co-op full time. So they'll, for example, do a summer fall co-op, but then for the spring they're supposed to come back and take their classes, right? But then some companies really want to keep the students, and so they will hire them for a part-time co-op. So where you're working up to 20 hours for the company while still taking your remaining classes. And that's also definitely also an option. And you know, we see students do that all the time, and your part-time co-op doesn't work against your full-time CPT hours. It's like an interesting part of how the F1B regulations are set up. And so you are able to then sort of like extend your co-op a little bit by staying on with the company part-time while still taking classes.
Great. Julian, can you just unshare? I just want to show that website link for the career, the salary stuff and info, because I think it's a really good resource for students to see. So this, there we go. Can you see that? My screen share was.
Yep.
Okay. Okay. So this is what that page looks like. So if you go back to the first page, the link I put in the chat, you can see all the different programs at RIT. Masters, bachelor's, PhDs. So if you drill into each of these different areas, you can see salary details for specific programs. So business analytics, if you go in there, you can see how many students are enrolled in the program, the minimum co-op salary, the average, and the max. So that gives you a really good range of what that looks like. And then you can also see outcomes rates, which I think is really important to see program by program. So you can see here with business analytics, it's 100%. And if the knowledge rate is very high, it's significantly higher than the average NACE, which is a national organization that measures this stuff. So you can see that we're getting information from students on a very regular basis, and that validates this number that we're putting out there, right? So. And then you can also see some details from internship and co-op experience level. And then here's the median and the average salary by program as well. So I think this is a really good resource to use. So definitely drill into that stuff. You can search by program. Remember, a lot of these salaries are entry level. So our MBA is skewed down a bit from this because we have students in various disciplines that impact the average amount. And it's also it's a larger program. So I think it's important to understand, you know, where these numbers and how they're calculated, but it is a very good resource to utilize and think about as you're working through the process and thinking about your options.
Yeah.
So there were two other, were there any cases where companies subsidized tuition while in co-op for students? I don't think that's the case.
Yeah, no, I don't think that's the case. The only types of situations where we see something like that is if you already had a job with a company and then they help pay for your master's and you're doing your master's part-time while working with the company right. full-time. Like that can be, but it doesn't usually work like that with co-ops.
Yeah, but remember too, you're not paying tuition when you're doing a co-op. So you can then use those funds to pay for tuition, you know, in your last term or something. So just remember that that's, you know, that's another key differentiator with the program.
Mm-hmm. And I think this question is for you, Matt. It says interviews are done invitation only. Interview will be alum or admission member. Is it also possible to bundle MBA and business analytics in a dual format?
So from an admission standpoint for the programs, we actually don't require interviews. We may request it if we want to get to know you a little more or just, you know, get a further sensor. But typically, we're only interviewing maybe 10 to 15% of our pool of applicants. And a lot of times, that's more specific to the MS program. So that's not something that's required. If we were to interview, Peggy Terrell would lead that. She oversees our graduate programs and then the program director. So for the MBA, it's Bill Dresnick. But again, we are rarely doing that, especially for the MBA. You can bundle the business analytics and MBA. Now, we are working on pathways to make this more coherent and more of a realistic option. So in that situation, you would want to take the MS program first, business analytics, and then you can share 5 classes from the MS program with the MBA. So in that instance, you would only have 11 courses remaining for the MBA. So you would get, you know, both degrees done in, it would be 21 classes as opposed to, you know, 27 or 28 for the, for what it would be, you know, if you didn't kind of bundle them together. So that is an option. That is something you can do, but the MS program has to be done first and then the MBA follows after that. And there's overlapping courses in those programs. So there's a data analytics course that's shared by both. So that would count. There's a couple other MIS courses that could count. So, but that is an option for sure. All right. Any other questions? These were great. So the MS in finance plus MBA with the data analytics focus, is this possible in 2 years? It would be. It would be a full 2 calendar years because you would need 6 semesters to do that, including summers. But yes, you could, again, start with the MS in finance and then add the MBA after the fact. Share those 5 classes and then it would be doable in 2 years. Yes. And again, we're really starting to ramp up in this space with the shared MS and MBAs. So there's going to be more on that and more opportunities to apply more coherently to those options. At this point though, if you wanted that pathway, you would apply to the MS program first and then we would process the MBA admission after that point. But again, there may be some changes coming with that, but it is certainly doable. That's excluding a co-op though. That's important because the co-op typically does extend the program by a semester if you did do a co-op. So there are some options where you could do a co-op and maybe take a class or two, but we do prefer students if they can to take it without courses. And that's important to not also be paying tuition. So.
Hi, Matt. Good morning. This is Dinesh. I just want to ask you one quick question. So I'm an international applicant, okay? So I have 8 years of experience in data analytics space. Now I'm trying to pivot into master's in finance because that's something I always wanted to pursue. Now I've not calculated my GPA as per US standards, and I do not have a GMAT score with me. What is the chance of me getting an admission?
So we do require the GMAT or the GRE for international students, unless you have a degree from the US. So you would need to take that exam to be considered. Now, in terms of the range of scores, we look for scores around the 50th percentile. So for the GMAT, or you could do the GRE, either or. We prefer the GMAT, but I know a lot of international students end up taking the GRE. The 50th percentile for the GMAT is about a 580 to 590. And for finance, we want to see pretty strong quantitative skills. For the GRE, it ends up being around 310 or so, somewhere in that ballpark. But we would need that exam for you to be considered.
Okay. Thanks, Matt.
Yep.
There's another question. It says, could you please share more insight on the kind of information that is specifically available on the RIT employment or job posting system? Sure. So there's four very specific types of things that you can find in that system. First, you can find resources. So we have a document library where there's going to be a lot of information and documents on resume writing, on preparing for interviews and stuff like that. So it can be like a nice library of content for you. Second, it'll be an events calendar. And so you will be able to see all of the events that you will be able to see at on campus related to the job search. And there's three types of events that you will find there. The first one is the career fairs. So you'll see any career fairs that are coming up. The second one, it's called workshops. And so workshops are things that my office is organizing to help you with the job search. So, you know, interview jobs, workshops, first resume writing workshops, et cetera, et cetera. And then the third type is info sessions. And so info sessions is information about companies that are coming to campus to do presentations or tables to meet students directly. And most of those nowadays, again, after COVID, are in person, but there are some companies that are still doing virtual sessions. So you will find a mixture of in-person and virtual info sessions in that system. And so that's two. The next information that you're going to find in the system is the ability to make appointments with your career services coordinator. And so you will be able to go in there and select an appointment and get booked. And you can book appointments, can be in person or virtual, depending on what your preference is. And finally, you have our job board. And so in that job board, you will be able to do search by using filters and also by using keywords for full-time positions and co-op opportunities.
Awesome. Thank you. It is a great system. It's a great resource. Yeah. And there's a lot of, I think just overall, I think the important thing to take away, whether you're an admitted student or a prospective, is we pump a ton of resources into career and co-op support. It is, you know, it's second to none in terms of the universities I've seen and worked with. So I think it's just really important to keep that in mind, as those resources are provided to you. You have to take advantage of them, and they're there, they're available. And you know, we're here to help. So, and that goes for not only co-op and careers office, but also your faculty, the staff you have, program directors, alumni, and the different ways that we connect. There's a lot of those resources that you can tap into. So
another thing that I forgot to mention is that the jobs that you'll find on Career Connect, it's not a feed. It's not like we're like pulling jobs from like Indeed or other places. These are jobs that companies are specifically posting at RIT because they want RIT students. So I think that's an important difference.
Yeah, for sure. All right. So this has been a great conversation. Could you share a class profile of MSBA program, including 23 and previous years? So I think in terms of the profile students coming in, so we have, there's two pathways for business analytics. There's the on-campus program and the online. The on-campus program is certainly the program that's more largely enrolled. So we generally have 25 to 30 students who start that program each fall. And we're trending that way again this fall and maybe even a little higher. I think we're at 20 deposits already and it's not even May 1st. So that program is very highly sought after. So, and again, that ballpark has been in place. We've grown a little bit from about the 15 to 20 range for the on-campus program to about 25 to 30. And that program is fairly heavily, not skewed, but it's a more of a international student body in terms of the on-campus program versus domestic. You know, we certainly have some domestic students pursuing it, but it is largely students coming from international, you know, countries, India being a big one for us, obviously, and then some students from China. We have partnerships with the Weihai campus at RIT, and then some students from all over. So Nigeria and Ghana have been a growing area for us in terms of where we see students coming from, and then some other locations as well, but those would be the big ones. But yeah, again, we're trending again to that range of 25 to 30 students on campus for the on-campus program in the fall. So it is, and it's our largest MS program, and it's probably even larger than the MBA in terms of students applying for it. So it is pretty competitive, but yeah, good question. All right. Any other questions that folks have?
It says the question is like layoffs. Is it gonna hurt incoming pool? That's really hard to predict. So I feel like layoffs affect some industries more than others. And so what I'm seeing is that, you know, maybe hiring is slowing down in some of the big tech companies like Facebook, for example, and, you know, those, you know, Google that are doing layoffs, but it's definitely not slowing down in other types of companies. Like consulting companies are continuing to hire. Anything that's in the energy sector, it's continuing to hire. Anything that's in the healthcare sector and also the healthcare technology sector is hiring a lot. So I feel like you can be successful in your job search as long as you really do a good analysis of what industries are trending up. And with the skills that you have as business students, you're like better positioned than any other student at RIT to do those kinds of analysis. So using a little bit of the skills that you're learning in your classes and apply them to your own job search can make you really successful because you can do a very detailed research of the types of companies that you should be pursuing. You can network with, so the question is, can I network with alumni from any business program or only from the program I'm enrolled in? You can network with anybody. Like they can be alumni from even other colleges. You can network with people who are not alumni of RIT. I will teach you how to do that when you come to RIT. That's actually one of my favorite sessions to do, just to show you how to really, really use LinkedIn and finding people. We also have a platform that's called Tigers Connect, where you can find mentors. And so there's a ton of alumni from RIT alumni from all of their different programs, and they have specific interests in different industries and stuff like that. And so you can find somebody that you will be compatible with to look for a good mentor. So that's also a great resource for you.
All right. Other questions? Man, it was a small group, but it was mighty. A lot of really good questions here. Good.
Yeah. Like the kids would say these days, those questions are money.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah. All right. So, I wasn't sure if we take the full hour, but we're pretty close. So I appreciate everybody jumping on. So I will, you know, I know you all attended this, but we will send out the recording of the session. I did schedule a couple what we like to call Ask Me Anythings over the summer. So if you are looking for more details and more information and just to get questions answered as you continue to search through processes, I will hold a few more Zoom sessions over the summer for that. So certainly feel free to jump on those. But thank you, Julian. Really appreciate your time. And thank you, everyone, for your great questions. It was really good session. I appreciate it. And we'll sign off at this point. But certainly thanks again for joining us, and have a good evening where you might be, or morning, wherever you are. And thanks again.
Yeah, thanks so much for inviting me, and thanks everybody for being here. I hope I will get to meet you in person in the fall.
All right. Thanks again. Bye.